On February the 28th, 1820, the Yorkshire village of Howarth made ready to welcome the new vicar. The cart went past the church towards the parsonage, which was to be their home for the rest of their lives. The Reverend Patrick Bronte walked up the hill with his four eldest children, Mariah, who was 7 years old, Elizabeth, aged 5, Charlotte, who was nearly 4, and the only boy, Branwell, aged 2½. Mrs. Bronte stayed in the cart with Emily, a toddler of 18 months, and baby Anne. The Brontes had arrived to take possession of their kingdom. They entered the new house and found one room to take over for themselves. They never called it their playroom. From the very first, it was their study.
Who were these studious children who came here that February day and turned a quiet Yorkshire village into a major tourist centre? Well, the place is still pretty much as they found it, even though a museum's been added and trees soften the bleak outline. The house stands up awash with the rising tide of gravestones. On the day they came here to the little village, which in those days seemed so remote, the family was keeping an appointment with destiny. In 35 years' time, all those 6 children would be dead. But between them, they would have written some of the most famous novels and poems in the English language.
Today, nearly a century later, every detail of their lives is known by countless admirers. After Stratford-on-Avon, Howarth is the most visited literary shrine in Britain. Here in Howarth, the Brontes were to find death and immortality. Patrick Bronte outlived all his children, and when Charlotte, the last of them, died, he took a bold step. He sent for Mrs. Elizabeth Gaskell, who was a friend of Charlotte's and a well-known novelist, and he asked her to write his daughter's life story.
I would wish you to publish an account of her life and works, just as you deem expedient and proper, and under your own name, so that the work might obtain a wide circulation and be handed down to the latest times.
Mrs. Gaskell began by making a sketch of the scene of the drama. Then she examined every scrap of paper she could lay her hands on and questioned all the neighbours and villagers. She wrote a great book, and through her, we know the story behind the story of the Brontes at Howarth.
I do not suppose there was ever a family more tenderly bound to each other. Mariah read the newspapers and reported intelligence to her sisters, who were so young, it's wonderful, they could take an interest in it. From their first going to Howarth, their walks were directed rather out towards the heathery moors than towards the long descending village street. A good old woman tells me that the 6 little creatures used to walk out hand in hand towards the glorious wild moors which in after life they loved so passionately, the elder ones taking thoughtful care of the toddling wee things.
The children were motherless now, for Mrs. Bronte died only a year after she came to Howarth. Mr. Bronte was left a widower with 6 little children to cope with. His wife's sister, Miss Elizabeth Branwell, came from Cornwall to look after them. Mr. Bronte had been a poor Irish boy, but he was clever enough to get to Cambridge. Though in some ways he was remote from his young family, he felt there was something special about his clever children. One strange episode stayed in his mind all his life, and he was able to recall it for Mrs. Gaskell in great detail.
A circumstance now comes to my mind, which I may as well mention. When my children were very young, when, as far as I can remember, the oldest was about 10 years old and the youngest about 4, thinking that they knew more than I had yet discovered, in order to make them speak with less timidity, I deemed that if they were put under a sort of cover, I might gain my end. Happening to have a mask in the house, I told them all to stand and speak boldly from under cover of the mask. I began with the youngest.
Come sit on my... Now. Now. Anne, my dear, what does a child like you most want?
Age and experience.
Very good. Good. Now, Emily, you know your brother Branwell is sometimes a naughty boy. What did I best do with him?
Reason with him. If he won't listen to reason, whip him.
Me next, me next.
Very good. Very good. Now, what is the best way of knowing the difference between the intellects of men and women?
By considering the difference between them as to their bodies. Now it's Charlotte.
Mm-hmm. What is the best book in the world, Charlotte?
The Bible.
Mm-hmm. And what is the next best?
The Book of Nature.
Very good. Now, Elizabeth, tell me, what is the best kind of education for a woman?
That which will make her rule her house well.
Very good. Now, Mariah, as the eldest, you tell us all. What is the best way of spending time?
By laying it out in preparation for a happy eternity.
Poor Mariah. She had not much time to prepare for a happy eternity. She was to die before she was 12 years old. Mr. Bronte wanted his daughters to have a good education. So he sent Mariah, Elizabeth, Charlotte and Emily to a school for daughters of the clergy at Cowan Bridge. It was a strict school and would have been a grim environment for any homesick little girl. But to the delicate Bronte sisters, it was fatal. In less than a year, Mariah and Elizabeth were brought home to Howarth to die. They were buried with their mother in the crypt of Howarth Church. Charlotte and Emily came home too. It had been their first glimpse of the outside world, and it had been so disastrous that it left them afraid for the rest of their lives of going away from the shelter of Howarth. It was 6 years before any of them left home again. Charlotte gave her sisters lessons in the children's study. A kind village woman, Tabitha Ackroyd, took charge of the kitchen.
Straighten it up a bit. That's it. Straighten it over.
Branwell had lessons with his father. Mr. Bronte, a Cambridge graduate, was better than most school teachers, but Branwell missed the discipline and competition of working with other boys. In the end, it was as disastrous for him to stay at home as it had been for the girls to be sent away to school at Cowan Bridge. There were few interruptions in their quiet life, but Charlotte always remembered one great day.
The history of the year 1829. I will sketch out the origin of our plays more explicitly if I can. Papa brought Branwell some wooden soldiers from Leeds. When Papa came home, it was night and we girls were in bed. Next morning, Branwell came to our rooms.
Charlotte! Anne, come out, I've got something exciting. Emily!
What is it? What have you got? Look. Oh, this is the Duke of Wellington. This shall be the Duke. This is mine.
I should have this one.
Can I have one?
Please, can this be mine?
Very well. They belong to all of us.
Mine was the prettiest of the whole, and the tallest, and the most perfect in every part.
Soon the soldiers were not just toys, but people in their own right. The Bronte children acted out the adventures of the young men, as they always called them.
She Wellesley, who protects you, is named Tali. She who protects Parry is named Emi. She who protects Ross is named Anai. These lesser ones you once saw are genie and fairies, are slaves and minions. We are the guardians of you all.
Before long, they began to write down the stories in tiny books that they made themselves.
Well, these are some of the actual little books made by the Bronte children out of scraps of paper with sugar bags for covers. And you see, the books had to be small enough for the young men to hold. And the writing's so tiny it can hardly be read at all. No wonder, in fact, that Charlotte became extremely short-sighted, and for the rest of her life she had to wear glasses, which was unusual in those days. But soon they invented a whole country where the young men lived. It had its own geography and history. They wrote all that down too. The capital city was called Glass Town. Naturally enough, some of the young men turned out to be writers. They wrote novels and poetry, and reviews of their work appeared in the Glass Town newspapers. Now, all of that came pouring from the pens of the four young Brontes. Well, in the years to come, between them, they published 7 novels and a volume of poetry. But that was only a tip of the iceberg compared with the countless volumes they wrote about their imaginary country.
Best plays are secret plays. They are very nice ones. All our plays are very strange ones. Their nature I need not write on paper, for I think I shall always remember them.
But Glass Town was solemnly destroyed when plans were made to send Charlotte to school again. They felt it was the breakup of their world. So Charlotte went off to school. She must have been terrified as she remembered her first dreadful experience of school 6 years before. But this time, it wasn't like that. Although the other girls teased her because of her old-fashioned clothes and her faint Irish accent, which she'd inherited from her father and never lost, she was happy during the 18 months she spent there. She met sweet, gentle Ellen Nussey, who comforted her when she was homesick and became her lifelong friend. Ellen kept every letter Charlotte wrote to her during a friendship that lasted a quarter of a century. The correspondence had begun when Charlotte returned home from Roe Head. But Charlotte did not tell Ellen everything in her letters. She had come back home, back to the real world of fantasy. Although Glass Town had been ceremonially destroyed, Branwell, now in his imagination, lived in a country called Angria, and Charlotte plunged into this with him. Emily and Anne had created a new country called Gondel, and they wrote stories and poems about Gondel and its people, especially about Augusta, its evil queen, for years. By this time, they were no longer making up children's stories, but inventing more and more mature happenings with wars and acts of heroism, destruction of cities and passionate love affairs. More and more, this creative life absorbed their energies, but it could be dangerous because it made them unable to cope with the real world. After Charlotte came home from school, they were granted a brief spell of happiness before the world claimed its victims. Years later, Mrs. Gaskell wrote,
"In fine and sunny weather, delightful rambles were made over the moors, down into the glens and ravines. Branwell was then a very dear brother, as dear to Charlotte as her own soul. They were in perfect accord of taste and feeling, and it was mutual delight to be together."
As long as they were together on the moors, they were happy. But they couldn't stay children forever. They all had to go out into the world to earn their livings, and their unhappiness began.
Emily is going to school. Branwell is going to London. And I am going to be a governess.
From first to last, Charlotte hated teaching and was uneasy with children when she had to. To escape from the narrow world of being a governess, she made a plan. She and her sisters would start a school for girls at Howarth. At least that would mean they could all stay home together. To improve her French, she went away to a big school in Brussels. But she was lonelier than ever and had an unhappy, unfulfilled love affair with a professor at the school. Back home once more, she wrote long letters to the man who did not know she loved him.
"I know it is not my turn to write to you. Ah, monsieur, I once wrote you a letter that was less than reasonable, because sorrow was at my heart, but I shall do so no more. I refrain from uttering a single complaint for your long silence. I would rather remain 6 months without receiving news from you than add one grain to the weight which overwhelms you. It hurts to say goodbye, even in a letter.
he never replied. Though the girl's prospects were so narrow, Branwell's seemed unbounded. His father and sisters believed that he was brilliant, certain to succeed in whatever he touched. It was decided he was going to be a famous painter, but first of all, he must go to the Royal Academy in London and become an art student. He went to London, but he never went near the Academy. No one knows why. Perhaps he was already afraid of failure. He came back, drifted from one dead-end job to another, and at last, sent away in disgrace, he was back at Howarth once more. Night after night, he went off to the local public house, the Black Bull, in search of the drink and drugs and companionship that were his only escape from the close family atmosphere.
Noble writings, works of art, music or painting, now, instead of rousing my imagination, cause a whirlwind of blighting sorrow that sweeps over my mind with unspeakable dreariness. And, if I sit down and try to write, all ideas that used to come clothed in sunlight now press round me in fevered black. I shall never be able to realize the too sanguine hopes of my friends.
Branwell's story was the tragedy of the only son from whom too much had been expected. Only a handful of his paintings remain, but although he never became the famous artist which his family longed for him to be, he will probably always be remembered for this. Now, this is only a copy. The original hangs in the National Portrait Gallery in London, amongst portraits of some of the most famous men and women ever to have lived in Britain. It's an attempt Branwell made at the age of about 18 to paint his sisters. This is Anne, this is Emily here, and Charlotte over here. Now, some experts do say that this space here was filled with a self-portrait of Branwell, but later the artist painted it out. It's a very sad, symbolic portrait. It's got rather an unusual history. It was forgotten by everyone, and was only found years after all the Brontes were dead, the canvas folded up and stored on top of a wardrobe, and the creases in the canvas, there they are, they can still be seen.
All the Brontes could paint and draw. This is Charlotte's drawing of Flossie, Anne's little spaniel. And this is Emily's of her dog Keeper. Branwell also painted this portrait of Emily. She loved Howarth and the moors even more passionately than the others, and the few times she went away, she became really physically ill. As she grew older, she cut herself off more and more from other people, and roamed the moors with her great dog Keeper, who cared for no one in the world but her. She was still faithful to her lifelong dreams of the land of Gondor, and poured out her soul in verse, which she put into the mouths of the characters in that unending chronicle.
A messenger of hope comes every night to me, and offers for short life eternal liberty. He comes with western winds, with evening's wandering airs, with that clear dusk of heaven that brings the thickest stars. Winds take a pensive tone, and stars a tender fire, and visions rise and change, which kill me with desire.
One day, in the autumn of 1845, I accidentally lighted on a manuscript volume of verse in my sister Emily's handwriting. I looked it over, and something more than surprise seized me. A deep conviction that these were not common effusions. To my ear, they had a peculiar music, wild, melancholy, and elevating. My sister Emily was not a person of demonstrative character. It took hours to reconcile her to the discovery I had made, and days to persuade her that such poems merited publication. Meantime, my younger sister quietly produced some of her own compositions. I thought that these verses, too, had a sweet, sincere pathos of their own. We had very early cherished the dream of one day becoming authors. This dream now suddenly acquired strength and consistency. It took on the character of a resolve.
So Charlotte added some verses of her own, and it was published, but not under the name of Bronte. At that time, public opinion was so much against any woman who tried to achieve anything, the sisters decided to adopt the pen names of Currer, Ellis, and Acton Bell. A dream had come true.
Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord. By thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. In the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Good night, girls. Don't stay up too late.
Good night, Papa.
Good night, Tabitha.
Although the book of poems was a complete failure, it had an important result. Now the three Bronte sisters thought of themselves as authors. Every evening they each worked on their novels. Charlotte's was called The Professor, and it was based on her experiences in Brussels. Anne's book was about a poor governess, and it was called Agnes Grey. Emily's novel was called Wuthering Heights, and it was set on the wild Yorkshire moors.
Heaven did not seem to be my home, cried Kathy passionately, and I broke my heart with weeping to come back to earth. And the angels were so angry that they flung me out into the middle of the heath, onto the top of Wuthering Heights, where I woke sobbing for joy.
After a great many efforts, Wuthering Heights and Agnes Grey were accepted by a minor publisher. Charlotte had no luck with the professor, but that was not her only worry. She was deeply concerned about her father. Mr. Bronte's eyesight was failing, and they were afraid he might go blind. Doctors said he was suffering from cataract, and an operation would save his sight. So Charlotte went with him to Manchester. Whilst he lay in a darkened room, she began work on a new novel. She called it Jane Eyre.
There was no possibility of taking a walk that day. We had been wandering, indeed, in the leafless shrubbery an hour in the morning. But since dinner, Mrs. Reed, when there was no company, dined early. The cold winter wind had brought with it clouds so somber and a rain...
Jane Eyre is about a governess, disconnected and poor and plain, Charlotte called her, who fell in love with her employer, Mr. Rochester. When it was finished, Charlotte sent it to the publishers, Smith Elder, who immediately and enthusiastically accepted it. It was published in October 1847, only 6 weeks later. It was an immediate success, and it's been a bestseller ever since. Some people were surprised that Charlotte called Jane, her heroine, a plain girl. And in those Victorian days, some readers declared that they were shocked with the frankness Jane expresses when she calls herself a woman in love. But almost everyone found the book unputdownable. It was actually published by Carabel, and Charlotte's authorship was kept secret from everyone. But at last, she felt she really ought to tell her father about it.
I had my suspicions of something going on, but never being spoken to, I did not speak on the subject.
Come in.
Writing a book.
Have you, my dear?
Yes. I want you to read it.
Oh, I'm afraid it will try my eyes too much.
Oh, it is not in manuscript. It is printed.
My dear, you've never thought of the expense it will be. It will be almost certain to be a loss. For how can you get a book sold? No one knows you or your name.
But, Papa, I do not think it will be a loss. And no more will you, if you will just let me read you some reviews and tell you more about it.
Do you know, Charlotte has been writing a book, and it is much better than likely.
It almost seemed like the beginnings of better times. Anne and Emily looked forward to the publication of Agnes Grey and Wuthering Heights, yet when these novels appeared, neither was well received. Emily was wounded by this, though she tried to take pleasure in Charlotte's success. She became more withdrawn than ever, and found release once more in poetry about Gondel.
cold in the earth and the deep snow piled above thee. Far, far removed, cold in the dreary grave. Have I forgot, my only love, to love thee, severed at last by time's all-wearing wave? Cold in the earth, and 15 wild Decembers from those brown hills have melted into spring. Faithful indeed is the spirit that remembers after such years of change and suffering.
On September 24th, 1848, Branwell's wasted life came to an end. He died aged 31 of drink, drugs, and tuberculosis.
It is not permitted us to grieve for him who is gone, as others grieve for those they lose. I do not weep from a sense of bereavement. There is no prop withdrawn, no consolation torn away, no dear companion lost, but for the wreck of talent, the ruin of promise, the untimely, dreary extinction of what might have been a burning and a shining light. My brother was a year my junior. I had aspirations and ambitions for him once, long ago. They have perished mournfully.
Branwell's death was not all. Emily caught cold at his funeral, and she soon became very ill.
I would fain hope that Emily is a little better, but it is difficult to ascertain this. She is a real stoic in illness. She neither seeks nor will accept sympathy. To put any questions, offer any aid, is to annoy. She will not yield a step before pain and sickness till forced. You must look on and see her do what she is unfit to do, and not dare to say a word. When she is ill, there seems to be no sunshine in the world for me. I would have written to you before, dear Ellen, if I had one word of hope to say, but I have not. She grows daily weaker. Moments so dark as these, I have never known.
If you will send for a doctor, I'll see him now.
No coward soul is mine, no trembler in the world's storm-troubled sphere. I see heaven's glories shine, and faith shines equal, arming me from fear.
Emily's funeral, coming less than 3 months after Branwell's, called for all their endurance. This was how Mrs. Gaskell described it.
As the old bereaved father and his two surviving children followed the coffin to the grave, they were joined by Keeper, Emily's fierce, faithful dog. He walked alongside the mourners and into the church and stayed quietly there all the time that the burial service was being read. When he came home, he lay down at Emily's chamber door and howled pitifully for many days.
This dreadful chapter in their lives was not over yet. Anne became ill. She was gentle and resigned to God's will, but tried hard to live for Charlotte's sake. Charlotte took her to Scarborough, hoping that the sea air might do her good. But it was useless. She died and was buried there to spare Mr. Bronte yet another family funeral. Charlotte came home alone. She had lost her brother and two sisters within the space of 8 months.
All was clean and bright waiting for me. Papa and the servants were well, and all received me with an affection that should have consoled. I am certain the dogs regarded me as the harbinger of others. The dumb creatures thought that as I was returned, those who had been so long absent were not far behind. I left Papa soon and went into the dining room. I tried to be glad that I was come home. I have always been glad before, except once. Even then, I was cheered. But this time, joy was not to be the sensation. I felt that the house was all silent. When I go out to the moors alone, everything reminds me of the times when others were with me. And then the moors seem a wilderness, featureless, solitary, saddening. My sister Emily had a particular love for them, and there is not a knoll of heather, nor a branch of fern, not a young bilberry leaf, not a fluttering lark or linnet, but reminds me of her. The distant prospects were Anne's delight, and when I look round, she is in the blue tints, the pale mists, the waves and shadows of the horizon. In the hill country, their poetry comes by lines and stanzas into my mind. Once I loved it. Now I dare not read it. The great trial is when evening closes and night approaches. At that hour, we used to assemble in the dining room. We used to talk. Now I sit by myself. Necessarily, I am silent. I cannot help thinking of their last days, remembering their sufferings, what they said and did. Whatever now becomes of the work, the occupation of writing it has been a boon to me. It took me out of dark and desolate reality into an unreal but happier region.
In these lonely years, she wrote two great books, Shirley and Villette. She began to be famous. She visited London and made friends. This was the time when she got to know Mrs. Gaskell. Her father loved to hear of her success and her adventures away from home. He was delighted when her publisher sent him a special present, a portrait of his famous daughter by the fashionable artist George Richmond. Charlotte always thought of herself as plain and insignificant, but that is not the impression gained of her from many of her pictures. This portrait was hung with great care in the parlour. Charlotte spent some of the money from her books on curtains and carpets, so that the parsonage had a more mellow air than in her childhood. But Charlotte was still alone a great deal, and when Mrs. Gaskell visited her, she was shocked at her friend's solitude.
No one comes to the house. Nothing disturbs the deep repose. Hardly a voice is heard. You can hear the ticking of the clock in the kitchen or the buzzing of a fly in the parlour all over the house.
No wonder that in her loneliness, Charlotte was very slowly drawn to one of the few people who did in fact come to the house. Arthur Nichols, her father's curate, whom she'd known for 8 years. She had received other proposals of marriage, but she'd turned them down because they did not fulfill her high romantic ideals. At first, when Mr. Nichols asked her to marry him and said that if she would not, he would go overseas as a missionary, she did not greatly care.
Oh, you did. Thank you. Will you excuse
the fact
me?
Is, I shall be thankful when he is well away. I pity him, but I don't like that dark gloom of his.
Miss Bronte.
He dogged me up the path after evening service in no pleasant manner.
Mr. Bronte was absolutely against the match, perhaps because he was too proud of his famous daughter to want to see her throw herself away on a penniless curate. Perhaps because he was afraid her health would break up under the strains of marriage. His very opposition made Charlotte more sympathetic to Arthur Nichols.
I have decided I can make him happy, and that his love is too good to be thrown away by one so lonely as I am. In fact, dear Ellen, I am engaged. I am very calm, very inexpectant. What I taste of happiness is of the soberest order.
Very nice, my dear.
I trust to love my husband. I am grateful for his tender love for me.
Oh. On June the 29th, 1854, Charlotte Bronte married the Reverend Arthur Nichols. Mr. Bronte still disapproved so much that he refused to give the bride away, or even attend the wedding.
The news of the wedding had slipped abroad before the little party came out of the church, and many old and humble friends were there, seeing her look like a snowdrop, as they say.
Reader, I married him. That is how Charlotte had begun the last chapter of Jane Eyre, written 7 years before. She felt the same amazement at her own marriage, which at first seems rather unromantic for such a passionate writer about women in love as she was. It turned out to be extremely successful. After a honeymoon in Ireland, they came back to Howarth Parsonage and lived with Mr. Bronte.
My life is changed indeed. To be wanted continually, to be constantly called for and occupied, seems so strange. We set off, not intending to go far, but when we had got about half a mile on the moors, Arthur suggested the idea of the waterfall. After the melted snow, he said it would be fine. It was fine indeed. A perfect torrent raving over the rock, white and beautiful. It began to rain while we were watching it, and we returned home under a stormy sky.
Inevitably, she caught cold. She became worse. She was going to have a baby and was dreadfully sick. And this, on top of her delicate constitution, sapped all her strength.
Dear Ellen, I must write one line out of my dreary bed. I'm not going to talk of my sufferings. It would be useless and painful. I want to give you an assurance which I know will comfort you. And that is that I find in my husband the tenderest nurse, the kindest support, the best earthly comfort that ever woman had. His patience never fails, and it is tried by sad days and broken nights.
Spare her, good Lord. I beseech thee. Spare thy servant. Heavenly Father, spare her.
I'm not going to die, am I? Surely you will not separate us. We've been so happy.
She died on March the 31st, 1855, aged 38. The last of the brilliant, fated Bronte children who had come to Howarth 35 years before. The three sisters who lived to maturity and achieved fame through their writing have made the village a place of pilgrimage. The parsonage is a Bronte museum now, lovingly cared for by the Bronte Society, but the thousands of visitors have made the quiet village a tourist attraction. What would they have thought of it all, the quiet family who lived out their lives here? Perhaps the answer lies in the words by which Emily brought the storms of Wuthering Heights to a close.
I sought and soon discovered the three headstones on the slope next to the moor. I lingered round them under the benign sky, watched the moths fluttering among the heath and harebells, listened to the soft wind breathing through the grass, and wondered how anyone could ever imagine unquiet slumbers for the sleepers in that quiet earth. Thank you.